Good morning. It is an honor and privilege to be here. My name is Komal Ahmed. I am the founder and CEO of Copia. And before I begin, I'd love to see a quick show of hands. How many of you have attended a conference, a wedding, had a lunch at Google, and wondered, God, what happens to all of this leftover food? Do they give it to the keynote speaker? Does the bride pack it up and take it on her honeymoon? Unfortunately, in most cases, this perfectly edible food ends up in the trash. And so I'm here to share how my team and I are changing that reality, how we're dramatically reducing food waste while solving the world's dumbest problem, hunger. I mean, for the first time in human history, we can use the same technology that you and I use every day to take a selfie, to swipe right, to request a Lyft, to instantly connect those with excess food to those in need. For the first time in human history, we can use technology for good. And truth be told, I wasn't even supposed to be here. As a daughter of South Asian parents, I had four very distinct career options laid out for me from an early age. Doctor, lawyer, engineer, or complete failure. Well, I always wanted to be a Bollywood actress. And as you'll come to find, I ended up doing something far more realistic, like solving world hunger. And this journey began for me a few years ago when I was a student at Berkeley. And I was walking down Telegraph Avenue when I encountered a homeless man who was begging for food. And something about him compelled me to stop and invite him to join me for lunch. And during lunch, he sat across from me, just like you are, scarfing down his food. He was unbelievably hungry. It wasn't a ploy for anything else. And in between bites, he shared his story. He said, "My name is John. I just came back from my second tour in Iraq. I've been waiting weeks for my military benefits to kick in. And because they haven't, you know, I haven't eaten in 3 days." And this really hit home for me. I mean, this is a veteran, someone who has given the most selfless sacrifice for our country, only to come home to face yet another battle, that of hunger and even of homelessness. And then adding insult to injury, right across the street, Berkeley's dining hall is throwing away thousands of pounds of perfectly edible food. You know, growing up, like perhaps many of you, I was also reminded by my parents, "Ekomal, don't throw away your food. People are starving in Pakistan." Though well-intentioned and true, what I realized after my lunch with John the veteran was that people go hungry, not just in the poorest nations in the world, but also in some of the wealthiest ones. Here in the Bay Area, one of the wealthiest places, not just in our country, but on the planet, 1 in 4 don't know where their next meal is coming from. Meanwhile, over 365 million pounds of perfectly edible food are wasted every single day. And to wrap your head around that massive number, imagine the world's largest football stadium filled to its absolute brim, not with last night's pad thai or this morning's half-eaten croissant, but untouched, unopened, amazing food. I mean, how is it that in a world with so much technology, so much innovation, so much abundance, so many still go without hunger? So many still go hungry. I mean, this is why my company has deemed hunger the world's dumbest problem, because we know that it's not a lack of food that's the issue, rather an ineffective distribution of that food. So hunger is not a scarcity problem, it's a logistics problem. And that's the logistics problem that I went off to solve. And I started by marching up to our dining hall managers and I said, "You know, what do you do with this excess food?" And they said, "Well, we try not to have any." And I said, "Well, how often does that work out for you?" And after a lot of pushing and prodding, they finally admitted that they do have excess food, but they have to throw it away. And so I said, "Well, why would you throw it away when you could go right across the street to people in People's Park and donate it?" And they said, "Because of liability, we don't do that." I said, "Yeah, you know, homeless people's high-powered attorneys are standing by just to sue you. Like, homeboy can't afford a hamburger, but somehow he can afford a litigator. And you were going to sell this food to us 10 minutes ago at full price. So 10 minutes ago was good enough for us, and now 10 minutes later, it's not good enough to feed people in need? Like, where's the logic there?" And I wasn't going to accept this answer, and so I did my own research. And I discovered that in 1996, Congress passed what is called the Bill Emerson Good Samaritan Act. And it protects all donors, regardless of whether you're a corporation, organization, or individual, from any liability when you donate your food. And get this, in the last 22 years, the number of lawsuits or legal claims that have been filed against any business or individual has been zero. but everyone and their mother has like a second cousin twice removed uncle's hotel that's shut down because they donated food, when in fact that never happened. And so I print all this out, I demand a meeting with the executive director of our dining hall, and I say, you know, I want to start this donation program, this is the right thing to do, here's all the protection. I can be pretty persuasive when I need to be. And so in less than 10 minutes, he agreed. And we went off to start one of the nation's first food recovery organizations on a college campus, which was essentially students picking up food from our dining halls, our on-campus events, our stadium, our arena, and then redistributing that food directly to the community. Great start, hugely inefficient. You know, one day I'm sitting in class and our dining hall manager calls and he's like, hey, Komal, no one came to this event, so we have 500 gourmet sandwiches left over. They need to be picked up in 2 hours, otherwise we're going to have to throw them away because we need the fridge space. So do you want them? I'm like, yeah, I want them. He's like, great, come get it. Mind you, I'm still sitting in class. And so I grab my bag, I dash across campus, I jump into a zip car, go through all these one-way streets up to our loading dock, and I begin loading this food into the trunk of my car. And it's perishable food, so it has to move as quickly as possible. And so I'm blasting the AC while I'm frantically trying to get the sandwiches in the trunk. And I finally do, and I slam the trunk, and I'm like, phew. Thank God this is amazing food. Of course there's going to be nonprofits that want it. And so then I proceed to call 30-plus nonprofits in Berkeley, in Oakland, even as far as Richmond. I'm like, hey, I have this amazing food. Could you use it? Hey, I have 500 gourmet sandwiches. Do you need them? A third of them don't answer the phone. A third of them say, no, we're okay. We don't need any more food today. Thanks. And then the last third are like, actually, you know what? We could use 10 sandwiches or 15 sandwiches. I'm like, great, now I have 485 sandwiches. And I swear, I was summoning my inner grandmother. I'm like, hey, you look so skinny, take this food, take it, eat it, to like random people on the street. And it was me pulled over to the side of the road so frustrated, thinking, why is it so hard to do a good thing? You know, why is it so hard to do the right thing? And where are all these hungry people at when I actually have amazing food to give them? And it was this frustration that was essentially the birth of my inspiration. I thought how much more effective, how much more efficient this whole process would be if those who have food could say, hey, we have food, and those in need of food could say, hey, we could use that food, and we match these two people, clear the marketplace, and solve a real problem for both of them. So essentially like a match.com for sandwiches. And so that's what we went off to build, essentially a platform that connects businesses with excess food directly to nonprofits in need anywhere across the country. And so, you know, we first started off with the nonprofits. And so nonprofits create profiles. They'll say, this is who we are. This is what we're looking for. They're sort of like dating profiles, except they don't lie to us about how many times they go to the gym. They'll say, this is the kind of food we want, packaged, prepared, ready-to-go meals. We want uncooked meat, produce. We want, if you're in San Francisco and super fancy, you're like, I only want gluten-free vegan food. I'm like, of course you do. And this is what our refrigeration capacity is. This is what our freezer capacity is. These are the best points of contact. This information is then stored in our virtual marketplace. And then for the businesses, so we work with food businesses. So if you think of like Whole Foods and businesses with food, so like Intel, Cisco, 49ers. And they essentially request pickups of their excess food. And they'll update us with the type of food and the amount. And then this information is then sent to our virtual marketplace, which kicks on our algorithm. Our algorithm will match this exact amount and type of food to the nearest nonprofit or nonprofits that could use that food at that day, that time, that quantity of food. It'll dispatch a driver nearly anywhere in the country to go pick up this food, take it directly to the nonprofit. The nonprofit confirms receipt of the food. They'll sign this automated, digitized tax deduction receipt. So the business gets to take advantage of the, you know, donations that are the financial savings that are available to them for their food donations. And the nonprofit will also send back photos and testimonials of the people that were fed. So you get to see the impact that you made by spending just a few minutes of your time essentially going Copia. And you know, Copia is not a nonprofit. We are not a charity. Copia is a for-profit company that's built proprietary technology to solve both hunger and food waste at scale. And so we work with a lot of innovative businesses across all industries that work with us not only because this is the right thing to do, but also because we're helping them save tens of thousands to millions of dollars for their food donations. And so in addition to finding a solution to easily and safely redistribute their excess food, We're also providing them data and analytics that help them understand, well, why is this waste happening, right? Is it Indian food? Is it Chinese food? Is it on Mondays? Is it on Fridays? Is it raining outside so employees didn't come to work or fans didn't want to go to a game? Like, why is this excess happening? And now we're using AI and machine learning to provide predictive analytics that help these businesses reduce overpurchasing and production altogether, along with, you know, access to tens of thousands, millions of dollars in tax deductions. And we provide this in a secure, seamless, audit-proof way, along with quantifying what their methane offset was. How many pounds of food did they divert from landfills? How many people did they feed? Where did this food go? And helping them share with their community, with their employees, with their customers, that their food is too good to be wasted, and that they've committed themselves to feeding people and not landfills. And so Copia has diverted over 1.5 million pounds of perfectly edible food from landfills, providing over $12.5 million in savings for the businesses and nonprofits we work with. And this year, we're gonna feed 2 million people with incredible food that would have otherwise been wasted. Thank you. And 2 million people is like filling up an NFL stadium 24 times over. If you think about that, the Raiders can't even fill up one NFL stadium, and we can fill up 24. And just to say, Raiders fans, we know the Niners can't fill up that many this year too, but they're a customer of ours, so. Speaking of the NFL, we've even partnered with the Super Bowl, where we recovered 14 tons of food. And 14 tons is like 4 16-foot refrigerated trucks filled from top to bottom, not with popcorn and hot dogs, but filet mignon, lobster rolls, $300 cheeses, pulled pork sandwiches. As a Muslim, not all my jam, but incredible food for the 23,000 people that we fed that weekend. We've even partnered with the Academy Awards, where we partnered with Vanity Fair, Slumdog Millionaire Superstar Frida Pinto, and Women in Film to ensure that for the first time ever, no food went to waste during Oscars weekend. And you know, this year, the Oscars weekend, one of the most exclusive and bougie events you can get into is the Vanity Fair post-Oscars after party. It was catered by Chef Thomas Keller, so the 3 Michelin star restaurateur from French Laundry. And we collected all of that excess food and took it across town to IRC, where we went to feed over 40 Syrian and Iranian refugees who had just come to America. So Chef Thomas Keller's food was their first group meal in America. I'm glad I set expectations. And I was joking that immigrants, when they come to America, they think they're gonna eat like kings and queens. We wanted to make sure that they could at least eat like Matt Damon. And they were just a few of the 1,100 people that for the first time ever got to eat like a star. You know, the scalability of our technology and frankly our entire model was put to the test when we were the first responders to the North Bay fires. And you know, before Salvation Army, before American Red Cross, before FEMA could even mobilize, Copia was on the ground providing food to tens of thousands of our fire evacuees, our first responders, as well as 500 members of our National Guard. And in the first 2.5 weeks of the fire, through our partnership with SF Fights Fire, we were able to provide over 34,000 meals in the first 2 weeks. And what this came to show me was that, you know, right now we're moving the most perishable resource there is, which is food. And, you know, eventually we could use the same technology, the same Match.com style of algorithm, the same logistics infrastructure, even some of these same nonprofit partnerships to help move medicine, medical supplies, books, clothing, anything, because it's not a lack of any of these resources, just an ineffective distribution of those resources. You know, so many people along my journey have said, come on, Komal, solving food waste, eradicating hunger, that's impossible. To which I respond with the words of the late and great Muhammad Ali. Impossible is just a big word thrown around by small men who prefer to live in a world as it is instead of using the power they have to challenge it, to change it, to improve it. Impossible is not a fact, it's an opinion. Impossible is temporary. Impossible is nothing. The impossible does not exist, and it can no longer exist. We should not tolerate a world where we waste 3 times more food than there are mouths to feed. We cannot tolerate it. We will not tolerate it. And so I invite you to join us whatever you do, wherever you are, whoever you are, there's a place for you. For the first time in human history, you can join us to actually move the needle on hunger and food waste in America. So whether you have excess food or you want to invest in the future, there's a place for you. One woman with a simple idea can make a world of a difference, but a group of people banded together can rid the world of one of the most unnecessary and solvable problems, the world's dumbest problem. Thank you.